Welcome to Cardio Insights, the podcast where we explore how digital solutions are transforming cardiovascular and emergency medicine. Featuring thought leaders from leading institutions across the globe, this series of conversations unveils the power behind clinical algorithms and decision support tools, and how they are changing the way we diagnose and manage cardiac conditions. From their impact on clinical practice, their benefits for patient outcomes, and the challenges they pose to health systems in terms of implementation and regulation, this podcast is intended as a precious resource for healthcare professionals in cardiology and emergency medicine who are curious to learn more about this exciting field. I'm your host, Matthew Jaffert, and you are listening to Cardio Insights. Welcome, Professor Baugh, to this episode of Cardio Insights. It's the first recording. So that's the podcast where we want to explore, you know, how digital solutions are transforming cardiovascular and emergency medicine. For our listeners who might be new to you, you are an associate professor in emergency medicine at Harvard Medical School, having recently completed a five-year term as the vice chair of clinical affairs for the Department of Emergency Medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital, where you trained in emergency medicine. Throughout your career, you have co-authored over 120 publications on topics related to cardiology, emergency medicine, oncology, but also in healthcare finance, policy, and clinical operations, just to name a few. So in this episode of the series, we want to discuss with you the challenges and the opportunities that digital decision-making algorithms in cardiovascular emergency medicine bring, and the considerations they require when we think about implementing and driving adoption of such tools. So before we dive into all these aspects, could you share, you know, with us how the emergence of these tools changed your clinical practice on a daily basis?
That is such a great question. I feel like my career has really bridged the analog phase of providing healthcare, and when I say analog, I mean pencil and paper, to a real digital electronic medical record with respect to order entry, decision support, documentation. When I was training 20 years ago, my note was a written piece of paper. I was writing orders on a clipboard at the head of the bed. And it's really been a revolution that I've got to experience. And what I love seeing is the potential in the future for where we could go now. I see a lot of potential that has not yet been realized. And that's why it's kind of a passionate area of interest of mine, because I feel like there's an opportunity right now to really innovate around this space. I feel like in recent years, the kind of digital tools that we're seeing are primarily focused on safety. Usually mm-hmm. there's a safety event, there's a review, and the outcome is that there's now going to be an alert that's going to prevent that safety event from happening again in the future. And as a result, they're designed to be very sensitive to not miss any cases. And as a result, they're often not so specific. And so it does create quite a bit of alarm fatigue among clinicians, and that very often the alert is not relevant to the patient in front of them. And I think that creates a lot of distrust around digital tools for decision support. So I think with all the revolution we've had with AI and kind of smarter design, and what we've learned about what good decision support looks like, I think we're at a point where really helpful, useful tools can be developed now. And I'm really excited to be at a point in my career when I can contribute to the development of those tools.
Beyond the safety aspect and all these alarms that you mentioned, where do you see the biggest potential today for improvement or for the development of new solutions in that regard?
So the area where I think it would be most helpful is around decision support to help make better decisions for clinicians, that, especially in the emergency department, who are making an astounding number of decisions in a short period of time. Mm-hmm. I feel like if you like making important decisions very quickly, work in the emergency department, because there are times when there are a line of people waiting to talk to me with a question. And some of those questions are very important. It could decide, you know, am I going to send this patient home or not? Am I going to call a consultant? Am I going to do a CAT scan to find a life-threatening diagnosis? And I'm making one decision after another. And so the idea of electronic systems helping me make better decisions in a way that I feel better off for having interacted with that tool than if I was on my own without the tool, that's where I think the future is. And so we need tools that are evidence-based, that are mm-hmm. done in the population that is that the clinician's actually practicing in, where it might catch an error where you didn't consider a factor and you're missing a diagnosis in your differential, or you're perhaps about to send someone home with a dangerous diagnosis. And then on the other end of the spectrum, I think supporting doing less for patients who don't need additional diagnostics mm-hmm. or treatments is going to be very helpful. Because right now I feel like we are misallocating our resources. We are not giving enough resources to sick patients that we're missing, mm-hmm. and we're probably over-testing a population of low-risk patients that could just be sent home safely, but we don't have the level of decision support integrated into our electronic systems to really help clinicians make that decision with confidence and know they're doing the right thing by doing less testing for those patients.
And in terms of implementation challenges, so you brought up one, which was what's more related to actually the use of these devices, where you have these alarm fatigue, where you know you get too many notifications or there's too much information. What are some of the other challenges that you see among, you know, within your practice, among your colleagues, in terms of implementing or adopting these solutions?
So there are challenges around making the evidence to know that the tool is working. Properly mm-hmm. working for your population. There are challenges around integrating those tools into electronic systems. You know, there are many different electronic medical records. So you need a tool that's going to be able to be integrated mm-hmm. into those different systems. You need to be able to have that alert be presented to the clinician at the right time in the encounter mm-hmm. that they're having. Mm-hmm. And then you ultimately need the clinicians to trust that recommendation and act on it. And so you need buy-in from them. And so that goes back to the evidence showing that the tool is going to give them good information. And then you need real world evidence as well, not just study evidence. Mm-hmm. And then you really need a cultural change around the way that these tools are viewed, because again, they're kind of traditionally viewed as not very helpful. And so the idea of saying we're in a new phase of decision support now, the smart decision support, where you're going to really miss these tools if they were taken mm-hmm. away from you. And what I would love to have is a clinician who moves from one spot to the next where these tools were embedded to where they're not. And one of the first pieces of feedback they give is, we need that tool because when I was using it before, mm-hmm. I was much better off. And so advocate for that tool to then be integrated into that system will be very important. I think, and lastly, there's a level of regulation that is happening now around these digital tools, especially ones that are more than just a clinical calculator. There are mm-hmm. lots of tools where it's a risk score. You put in yeah. different aspects of the patient, their age, their gender, et cetera, and then it gives you a number that goes back to a risk score. That's helpful, but ultimately, I think we're going to go towards probably more nuanced decision support that takes into other accounts. It might take more of their risk factors into account. It may their presentation, the quality of their chest pain for a chest pain patient. And those more nuanced ones are probably going to need evidence, and they're going to need to be regulated to some degree. Mm-hmm. And so this is a new era in regulation for these digital tools. So I think a lot of folks are still figuring out how to navigate mm-hmm. that regulation. And then lastly, these tools are going to need to be updated because new evidence arrives all the time. And when you're talking about governance around making sure that the tool that you're using is using the most up-to-date information, you know, the kind of updates that happen often are delayed, and that there's no room for that delay when you're talking about care of patients. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, when we see these big specialty society guidelines around things like chest pain, they come out every 4 or 5 years. And, you know, the update on the digital tool can't wait 4 or 5 years. It needs mm-hmm. to be continuously updated. And I don't know if we have a good mechanism for that right now, mm-hmm. But that's certainly going to need to be integrated in the future.
One thing that would be interesting to understand was, you mentioned the level of evidence around these tools and the importance it has on, you know, the selection from clinicians as to whether or not they would use it. How do you see, you know, how clinicians actually make the selection, because there is more and more tools available. There's also this point solution fatigue that I think is quite recognized as well. What's the decision-making process as to, you know, we use that, we don't use that?
So ultimately, if there are multiple tools around the same disease process mm-hmm. that are, say, available to be integrated into the health record, the leadership at the hospital or health system record is going to need to evaluate all of those tools, mm-hmm. just like how they might evaluate a different test or assay to be like, yeah. there are multiple different troponin assays or multiple different, you know, types of stress tests. Mm-hmm. They're going to need to figure out which one are we going to allow our clinicians to have access to. And it could be that for some tests or tools that they're complementary in some way, and so we're going to have them all available. And others, they're going to have some a choice to be made, right? To say, hey, we're gonna go with this one tool because we feel like it's the best tool for our patient population, and we believe the evidence is most robust. Mm-hmm. And there may be some discordance around the clinicians. There might be some who say, well, I like this other tool, I want to use that one. But you're going to need to have the leadership get everyone on the same page around saying, at this site, we're going to be using, you know, this particular mm-hmm. tool. And then it's going to be important also not just to get, say, emergency physicians to all be on the same page, but you need, if it's a cardiac tool, you need the cardiologist in the group to also be on the mm-hmm. same page. Because very often, the tool is going to make a recommendation, like, this is a patient who needs to be admitted to cardiology. If the emergency physician is using that tool and believes in it, and the cardiologist does not believe in that tool, you're going to have conflict. Mm-hmm. And so you need everyone in the institution to be on the same page around what the standard of care is there and have a common expectation.
Mm-hmm. And is there also a responsibility from health systems or, you know, broader health systems beyond, let's say, the individual hospital level where this has an influence on which types of tools are being used or implemented?
I think we're seeing a lot of consolidation, at least in the United States, of hospitals into larger and larger health mm-hmm. systems, mm-hmm. usually a mix of academic centers and community centers. And what I'm seeing is a lot of decisions that are made at a more central level, and then tools and resources are pushed out to the whole system to have some harmony across mm-hmm. all of those different hospital settings. I think some tools will need to account for different resources available locally at different hospitals. For example, in cardiology, you could have a community hospital that does not have a cath lab mm-hmm. Versus a big academic center that does. And so you can imagine if the recommendation is for emergent cardiac cath, it's a different kind of set of actions for a community hospital than an academic hospital. Yeah, a community hospital, it can mean you need to transfer that patient right away, whereas the academic center is you need to activate your cath lab. But I think hospital systems can act to advocate for those smaller hospitals that maybe on their own, if they weren't part of a larger system, wouldn't have access to these tools, because there often is a pretty big concentration of resources in big health systems that might be able to bring these tools to disseminate them to smaller hospitals that may just have a very limited budget and expertise around IS, but being part of that larger system gets them that benefit.
And how do you see the role of regulators in providing some degree of guidance on, you know, which tools to use? Because obviously they are responsible for certifying them. They're classified according to a certain framework in the US, in Europe. But is there also like a responsibility from their end on, you know, providing guidance to clinicians, to health systems as to, you know, for which conditions, which tools are the most relevant?
I think regulators are going to set some safety standards. I think that's probably where their interests mm-hmm. are. They want to make sure that the tool is being used appropriately and that the bar is set at mm-hmm. a level where tools that are being used have met some minimum standard around a level of evidence. And they want to prevent the tools from being misused mm-hmm. or applied to the wrong clinical scenario, the wrong population. At the same time, I want to make sure regulators are not putting undue burden mm-hmm. on the development of these tools that would delay their creation and implementation or increase, the cost and time needed to get a tool developed and integrated to the point where fewer tools are available because of the burden of creating them from a regulatory perspective. So, and this is also a relatively new and emerging area of regulation of digital tools as we kind of move away from the calculator type of decision support to more nuanced decision support, even AI guided decision support. Mm-hmm. You can imagine mm-hmm. a future where there are AI agents that are kind of looking out for the patients and running all of this analysis in the background that's very sophisticated, that goes well beyond a calculator, that are making recommendations to the clinician that they can use or not use. One would imagine that a certain amount of regulation is required for those agents to make sure that they're, I mean, right now we see what we call some hallucinations with, with AI, right? Where it's making up references or making, or like assuming an answer is desired and giving that answer, even if it's the wrong answer. And so I think regulators are going to want to make sure that that does not happen to where there's harm caused to a patient. And I can understand that and appreciate that. Mm-hmm. At the same time, the rate of development in the AI space is happening so quickly that I think we're not very far away, and we may have tools developed by certain people that's actually today available that has a level of sophistication to where they could really be implemented today and be right and be really helping patients. Mm-hmm. And so I'd love to be able to have those integrated and to be able to use them. I just want to make sure the regulators are allowing those to be developed.
I see. You know, we're getting towards the end of our conversation, and we have a recurring question across all the episodes of the series for the external stakeholders and health leaders we interact with. And that is, you know, if you had a magic wand, which digital solution would you like to have in your clinical practice that is, from your perspective, missing at the moment?
Yes. And so I would say, if we're talking in the theme of cardiology, I would say around chest pain and really deciding which patients need further chest pain diagnostics is something that I feel like is missing right now. And so right now, if I have a patient with chest pain, which is very common in the emergency department, we're talking about on a typical shift, I'll see three or four patients with chest pain. It's about 6% of all ED visits in the United States. And I feel like it can get very complicated to do a lot of the calculations in your head right now. There's the gestalt around kind of how worried you are about that patient.
Yeah.
And then there's all the factors around their history and their EKG interpretation and their troponin interpretation. We're now using high sensitivity troponins more often. Those might have multiple values that you need to interpret, both the absolute and delta values. And you're trying to integrate all of that into am I done and can I send the patient home, or do you need to keep them? I feel like there's an opportunity to integrate tools there that would help give me confidence that I'm not missing unstable angina, which is the element of acute coronary syndrome that is the hardest to diagnose in the emergency department, because by definition, you're not going to have a troponin elevation in those patients. And that's the population that really would benefit from staying for cardiac stress testing or a coronary CTA. And so I feel like if there was a tool that said, this patient does not have unstable angina or occlusive coronary disease, and I don't need to do further testing, that would be incredibly valuable to me. I feel like we're very close to having that tool available today. It's and then, you know, longer term, you talked about these AI agents. I'd love to have an AI agent who's kind of like a guardian angel on my shoulder, who's looking at all of my patients and thinking about other chest pain diagnosis besides ACS, looking at, you know, is this a pulmonary embolism? Is this an aortic dissection? What are the life threats that my job in the emergency department is to not miss? I'd love to have that resource available to make me better, to feel like, hey, my job is easier now and I can rest, you know, easy at night, knowing that I didn't miss something dangerous. And I'm not going to get that email in a couple of days that you remember that patient you saw a few days ago. I hate getting those emails the tap on the shoulder, because very rarely it's like, hey, they're back and they brought cookies for the department because they're so happy about how well they are cared for. No, you know, usually it's something bad happened to them. And so I'd love to eliminate that from my practice and my colleagues' practice as well.
Yeah, understood. Thank you so much, Professor Baugh.
Yeah, my pleasure. This was great. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Cardio Insights. We hope you enjoyed it. If you want to dive further into other aspects of digital solutions in cardiovascular and emergency medicine, check out the other episodes of the series. To support the show, you could share this episode with your surroundings and leave a 5-star review on your preferred streaming platform. Cardio Insights is a podcast brought to you by Roche. Thank you for your time, and see you in the next one.